Hey guys, welcome back. So now getting into Jerry Dugan's Savage Avengers. I was reading this and I was thinking, I'm sure there's a few things in here that you guys want me to break down. And so in response to my own thoughts, I just said, okay, why not? And so now Savage Avengers, you can just tell by the cover that this is a narrative about heroes who need to work together more than they want to, which really isn't too much of a new thing, but in this case, Conan steals the show. And from what I've seen so far, like, he's the one who really has me turning the page. And so let's get into this. But first, if you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to catch the spills every week. And don't forget to hit that bell up top so we can squat up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so now hopping into this, it jumps off pretty quick because we begin at a concert in Vienna headlined by Signore Saviano, who just shut it down. And Saviano is an Italian opera singer who's world renowned. But after this performance, his life got flipped, turned upside down because a dude waiting in his limo with chloroform and a rag in his hand had kidnapped him and dragged him out to the Savage Land. Nah, but out here in the Savage Land, we're introduced to a new portion known as the City of Sickles, to where their main temple houses this huge, like, stone bowl, to where they sacrifice the greatest warriors, the greatest thinkers, artists, and they're spilling their blood within this bowl in hopes of summoning Jotun Lao, who will return once a millennium under specific requirements. And at this current time, these sacrifices are being led by the priest Johann Richter. And with him having Saviano abducted and brought here, his reasons for doing this were twofold. One, because he met the requirements to have his blood spilled in the bowl, but also because he knew Saviano had powerful friends who would come looking for him, which is why Richter left a loose trail so hopefully they would follow and become subject to the sacrifice as well. So then when he tells him it's an honor to be a part of the sacrifice and just kills him, and after that compliments him on his talent, it just makes you think, like, well, how many people in his pit are on your Spotify playlist and in your fantasy league? But also, around this time, you also have Conan, who's made his way to the Savage Lands in search of an amulet to which he's been told is being held within the City of Sickle. And so now, I feel like I gotta say a couple things about Conan because I feel like he's an interesting choice for this narrative. Because Conan is like a huge throwback. He's been in comics since like the early 50s. And then he was acquired by Marvel and they put out his first issue like in 1970. And then he went over to Dark Horse Comics from like 2003 to 2018 and now he's back in Marvel. But I like it. And it's not necessarily because I'm a huge Conan fan. But when I first heard the title Savage Avengers, I thought, okay, we're gonna get Kazar, who we've talked about like on the Black Panther playlist and on older 1610 videos, when we had talked much about the 1610 universe. But much like how Kazar kicked it off with Jungle Action and then Black Panther with his success with the Fantastic Four, he just took Volume 2 and just took over from there. It's like, I can't help but feel a little bit of that with Conan showing up a lot more recently and fulfilling a role that arguably could have been done by Kazar. But with that being said, I also want to add in there that I'm not mad at that, because when comparing Conan and Kazar, Conan is hands down unbridled savagery. And when you hand that to writers like Jerry Dugan and Jason Aaron, you just get to take the narrative places to where Kazar just wouldn't measure up. And so as far as Conan and his time here in the Savage Land, he's been here roughly for a few weeks, beating up and eating dinosaurs and crocodiles, and really just passing through the many tribes that live within the Savage Land. And that's how he's gotten word of this amulet that he's been searching for within the City of Sickle. And so moving his way closer to Sickle, coming down from the mountains, he's run into members of the Hand, and he's just brutally tearing them the pieces, because for Conan, they're just in the way. But as far as the Hand, they're trying to get him back to the City of Sickle so they can chop him up and drop him in the blood bowl. But while Conan is fighting off the Hand, swinging the sword all willy-nilly, he catches one in the head and it makes a clang sound, to where at this point he figures out, okay, you somebody else. And mind you, this is Conan's first time meeting Wolverine, and Wolverine's just looking back at him like, okay, you shouldn't have gone for the head, like, that was a mistake. But with this being like their first official time meeting, this isn't their first match up in comics, because forever ago in the What If series, we had an instance where we had Wolverine versus Conan. But like we talked about before, these What If scenarios are like your alternate reality and your alternate universes, which at the time just allowed Marvel to play with these different ideas. And so here, with Wolverine and Conan meeting for the first time, it's like you already know it's about to go down. Because one, Wolverine has a thing for just popping up on people unannounced. And whether or not he's the one looking for the fight, to where, come to think of it, 9 times out of 10, he's the one who is. But it's not so much in every instance that he knows that this is the situation he's about to run into. So when he runs into Conan here, he's just like,
oh, here we go again.
And from there, it's just an all-out brawl. And so now for Conan, who doesn't have like this crazy healing factor, and historically he's like a peak human with like the strength and endurance and toughness of like 20 men. And so in the past, he survived some crazy blows that would have been like fatal to a normal human. But as far as healing factor goes, he's no Wolverine, not by a stretch. He's just more durable, with the exception of not having an adamantium skeleton, but his physical durability allows him to go toe-to-toe with Wolverine. But at the end of the day, it don't matter how durable you are, because when Wolverine kicks him in the conads, it's like you still gotta remember there's adamantium bones in that foot, or adamantium laced bones. Still, I would say it's safe to assume that the sensation is anything less than pleasant. But with these two going back and forth, and really at this point, not really like fighting, because they're exchanging blows, yes, but they're not trying to tear each other to pieces, but rather it's here that they're discovering, like when Conan stabs Wolverine in the chest and thinks he's dead, it's like they're discovering, okay, we never met, but we're definitely two of the top tier, toughest, rawest, most savage, in pun very much intended. But it's like they're both discovering the hard way that they're two of the toughest people they've ever met. And for me, like, this is one of the places where Conan, he really steals the show. And it's like the basis of their whole argument is like Wolverine telling Conan like to go the other way, and Conan refusing to take orders from anyone, and also refusing to back down from anyone. But when Wolverine uses his adamantium claws and slices Conan's sword in pieces, he's triggered. And at the same time convinced that this dude is a demon. Like, man, you should have seen Wolverine in Marvel Now. But as it turns out, their back and forth actually puts them both in the place that they're trying to go. Because when Conan rushes Logan, knocking them both off of a cliff, they actually fall in the City of Sickle. Or the City of Sickles, is plural, more than one sickle. But after landing here and getting to have a decent conversation after beating the mess out of each other, Conan tells Logan that he arrived here after a battle with the Avengers, which is why he's been in the Savage Land for weeks, to where Logan's like, oh, left somebody behind in the Savage Land. Yep, sounds like Earth's Mightiest Heroes. But more or less it's here that they understand their different agendas, with Logan looking for a friend that was kidnapped and brought here, and Conan more or less searching for an amulet, with Logan telling Conan that he's Logan of Pabst, and Conan knows none the wiser, because he's probably hadn't seen a liquor store yet, even though they literally just landed like in a brewery. But from here, jumping over to Madripoor, we got Jericho Drum, also known as Brother Voodoo, who's been summoned to see Ma, and not the creepy one that throws teenage parties in her basement, but the mother of Yoon, who was taken, then forced by the hand to force her hand to lure out Brother Voodoo in order to snatch him up and take him to the City of Sickles. And so now, once priest Johann Richter has his hands on Brother Voodoo, this plays out exactly how he wants. Because for one, he wants Brother Voodoo to offer for the sacrifice, to which he does right in front of Wolverine, but also he had intentionally made this act of taking Brother Voodoo and leaving the trail as a form of bait to lure Wolverine out here. But as far as more history on the sacrificial offering to Jotun Lao, which predates Johann Richter, because he's from like World War II, like he was a German pilot who crash landed in the Savage Lands and he's been there since, but predating him and going back over 100,000 years, here in the City of Sickles, this cult, which at this point is yet to be named, they've been sacrificing the greatest of warriors to Jotun Lao, which is a ceremony that they repeat every millennium, with the hope that Jotun Lao will return and take the people here with him to his planet of paradise beyond Pluto. And there's other elements which come into factor as well, like with every millennium, the planets have to be in a certain alignment in order for him to make his way here every millennium. But more or less, the City of Sickles was built around this bowl for the purpose of this sacrifice and in honor of the Morrow God, in order for this to be his place of arrival. And so now, in the case of Johann Richter, who is going 10x with his method of execution, he's allied with Egyptian cults and the Hand in order to make sure that this time the bowl is running over. And the main reason for him going so hard at doing this is because prior to this date, with every appearance of Jotun Lao, every time that he would appear every millennium, he would see the sacrifice as inadequate, and from there he would just pretty much slaughter everybody out of disappointment. And for that reason, Richter is going above and beyond in hopes that he doesn't see the same fate. But I gotta say, I can't help but notice the similarities between this Morrow God and like your Venom symbiote, which leads me to believe the possible connection between him and Null, the god of the symbiotes, because I feel like that would make a lot of sense. Or even possibly a connection to Carnage, with Absolute Carnage being right around the corner, because I'm pretty sure when that kicks off, it's gonna be mayhem incarnate. But that'll do it for this one, guys. But what we do know is that the events taking place here in the Savage Land in the City of Sickle is gonna draw out a few more characters, and the deeper we get into it, the less I believe that the selection of these six, with Venom, Brother Voodoo, Conan, the Punisher, Elektra, Wolverine, it's like the less I believe that this is any coincidence. But let me know what you guys think down in the comments below, and we'll do it again in the next one. All right. Later.